Good evening.
Good
to see each of you and each of you out this evening. We had 68 this morning. 68. Dennis, do you know how many of them were actually visitors?
I wrote down 17 people.
17?
That included, that was Ben and Rachel here this morning, wasn't it?
Yes.
That included them.
Okay. Right, they're Martinsburg is where they're at, yeah. I'm glad for the visitors this morning. We have quite a few that's of our own that are away vacationing. 433. I just looked who was down for opening prayer. Who is it? Tom. Tom is, yes, I just remembered. When I start getting up here and can't remember what I'm up here for, just tell me to go sit down. Because it's coming quick. Coming quick.
You're down for closing prayer.
Yep. Remind me later.
I tell you, you got me reading this bulletin.
That's good. If I got you reading the bulletin, that's good.
It only took 3 months.
Following the seamless hymn, Brother Tom will direct our minds in our opening prayer. Pure and heart of God. Too high here. I got the wrong one there. I'll blow it with my pitch pipe. Sorry about that. Too low. What am I doing? That's a C. Well, no wonder. I know what I'm doing now. Duh. Yeah. I told you, it's coming fast.
With thee abide pure. face one day may see. Keep me from secret sin. Reign thou my soul within.
Dear Heavenly Father, we're so thankful to you for this evening hour. We can be here to hear another portion of your word. We pray that as your people, we would be humble and loving and looking towards you in all things, that we might reach out to those who are lost around us. We thank you for our visitors who've been our way today, and we pray to bless them as they travel and continue to come back and be with us. Continue to be with us through the rest of this service. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Song of encouragement this evening will be number 376. If you want to mark that in your hymn books, 376. After you mark that, to turn your hymn books to number 98. 98.
Face to face with Christ my Savior, face to face, what will it be? When with rapture I behold him, Jesus Christ, who died for me. Blissful moment, face face to see and know. Face to face with my Redeemer, Jesus Christ, who loves me so. Face to face shall I behold him, far beyond the starry sky. Face to face in all his glory, I shall see him by and by.
Good evening. You all look as tired as I am. Ben is a physical therapist, is that right? And he looked me over the day. And they believe that I have frozen shoulder. And it's my left shoulder. And that's the same side that that Laura sleeps next to. So things get a little cold there at the house, I'll just say that. But Scott said somebody can judo chop me or something and knock that thing right back in place. So tip me upside down, is that what you're saying? But he's not sure that's what it is. So... it's not that bad. He said, man, you can move it pretty good places, but boy, there's just certain places that I can't. So today I just laid on my back. I don't do that because I end up snoring something fierce. And today I figured she can get up to the other room. I'm going to lay down. So she didn't. She just stayed right there. So what are you going to do? All right, let me look at the time. I really don't want to keep you long tonight. But I want you to turn to 1 Corinthians here. Well, if you'd like. I suggest turning every time you go to hear a sermon. It always helps me. I understand sometimes it's a bother to get up and to turn, and I have to watch that. Laura has told me I'll say a scripture, then I'll go right through it, and I don't give people time to get there. So I figured tonight I'd tell you 1 Corinthians chapter 6. 1 Corinthians chapter 6. There's that. I've got pages coming out of my Bible. Elizabeth, before you're allowed to go to school, you have to glue this page back in my Bible. It's been that way for how many years? I don't have an Acts 20, so if anybody asks me a question at Acts 20, we're in trouble. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 9 through 11. Know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? So it's chapter 6, verses 9 through 11. Know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? Be not deceived, neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor effeminate, nor abusers of themselves with mankind. Now, Elizabeth had asked me a question this week. When dealing with sexual immorality in the Bible, she brought up that it was a common practiced amongst the Romans, and it began with the Greeks for the soldiers to take young boys along with them. It's my understanding that this word effeminate here to some extent references such a person. And that's the verse there, Elizabeth, that you were asking me about. So, nor effeminate, nor abusers of themselves with mankind, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners shall inherit the kingdom of God. And then it says, and such were some of you. But ye are washed, but ye are sanctified, but ye are justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God. Now, in verse 7, Paul addresses something that's unique. He says, now therefore, there is utterly a fault among you because you go to law one with another. So what's going on here? Well, they were taking each other to court. These are Christians who are quarreling amongst each other, and they're going before the magistrates of their local communities and are taking one another to law. I want you to notice the question that he asked them. Instead of taking each other to law, instead of quarreling, instead of fighting amongst yourself, notice verse 7. Why do ye not rather take wrong? Why do ye not rather suffer yourself to be defrauded? This is something that I would like you to think about. What do I mean by this question that I'm asking you? Well, what does Paul mean? He's saying, okay, you all are fighting over stuff. Somebody has offended another person. And do you notice who he appeals to? Not the one who does the offending, but the one that was offended. And what does he say about it? Again, why do you not rather take the wrong? I've often heard my own brethren, and I suppose I've uttered it myself, ain't nobody gonna get one over on me like that. You ever said that? Or here's another one. It's the principle of the thing. And what does Paul say to do? Why don't you just take the wrong? Then he goes on and he says, why do you not rather suffer yourself to be defrauded? I have literally been defrauded before. People have stolen stuff from me. People have taken things without asking. And many times, you know what I do? I just let it go. What are you going to do? Is it worth making an enemy over? When someone has done something wrong to you, many times if you point it out, it's like shaking a hornet's nest. Now, have you ever dealt with people? I'm sure you have. Many times it's best to think about things before you try to enact some kind of vengeance upon that person. And so in verse 7, he points out that those who are taking one another to law are being sinful. And notice of whom he lumps them in with: the fornicators, the idolaters, the adulterous, the effeminate, the abusers of themselves with men, thieves, covetous, drunkards, revilers, extortioners. And he ends the list by saying what? And such were some of you. And the question becomes, is there any sin in that list that is unforgivable? As a matter of fact, Jesus points out an unforgivable sin. You remember what it was? To sin against the Holy Spirit, to blaspheme against the Holy Spirit. And here is a list of what we would consider to be some of the worst sins that there are. But he says we know that they're forgivable sins. Why? Because you were some of them. Some of you were practicing them. That's better. When I was at Barnesville, they had within the Church of Christ a man that I knew to be a fine gentleman. And he was an older man. He had a family. I realized he was a little older when he had kids, which I can relate to recently. But I was having him help me with things. And someone said, "Do you know about him?" And I, when people in the church, by the way, if you come to me and ask me that question, here's the answer I want you to know. I don't want to know. All right? I just don't want to know. If they've been forgiven for whatever they did, I'm not worried about it. Unless it's something I need to worry about. Someone said, "Do you know him?" I said, "Yeah." And I told him what his name was. "No, I don't mean that. You know what he used to do?" And I said, "How long ago?" He said, "Oh, when he was younger." Well, he was an old man at this time, clearly past 73.7 years, right? And before I could say I'd rather not know, they said, "Well, he was a practicing homosexual." You know what I said to that? "How long has he been married?" "Well, he repented of that 40 years ago. I said, "Well, Jesus forgot it 40 years ago. How come you didn't?" Isn't it interesting that we hold on to stuff so long and so tightly? Such were some of you. Such were some of you. The unrighteous, here in 1 Corinthians, we are told, shall not inherit the kingdom of God. And yet we have people who deal with heavy things all the time. I think it was around this time last year, I had Elizabeth come up and hold that bottle of water. You all remember that? And I asked her if it was heavy, and she said no. I just let her stand up here for about 5 minutes while I preached. You notice it started to get a little heavier? Let me ask you a question. What is a bottle of water? 20 ounces? 16 ounces? 16? No, it was just one of those little ones. No, not that little. It was a regular bottle of water. 16 ounces. Yeah, we're going to say 16 ounces. So how heavy is 16 ounces? All right. So that's not very heavy, is it? But the longer you hold it, what happens? I mean, the weight hasn't changed at all. But your arm starts to get tired. If you hold it for an hour, you have an ache in your arm. If you hold it for a day, doctors say your arm will feel numb and paralyzed. Why don't you volunteer to try that? Just hold a bottle of water out for a whole day. We'll see if that works. But the stresses and the worries and the sin of life are like that bottle of water. It doesn't seem so heavy at once. By the way, it doesn't change much. Sin is sin. It may come packaged a little differently each time, but the core of it's still the same. It's from the devil. And at first, it may not seem like much of a burden, but when you carry it for so long, it becomes very, very, very heavy. And that's what the cross is for. At the cross, we take that burden and we lay it at the feet of Jesus. And that should be where it stays. Now, this is one of those sermons that I have trouble preaching. For years, I used to preach, cast every care and burden on Jesus. And I'd go home and I'd think, "Well, Josh, you sure sounded like a preacher up there." But then I'd argue with myself about how in the world do you cast all your burdens on Jesus and stop worrying? Did you know your preacher has these inner struggles? Lately, I've been talking to myself out loud and answering myself out loud. So this is another one of those. How do you let go of guilt? "Oh, there are a lot of things in my life that I regret." I envy the person who says, "No regrets." I wish I could say that. But I live with regrets. I'm one of these people. Memories haunt me. You know what I mean? Things I wish I would have done differently. Things I wish I wouldn't have done. And here the author of the book of 1 Corinthians is saying, that's what you were. But you have been washed. You have been sanctified. You have been justified. You wonder why it's so hard to answer the question, are you saved? The common answer is simply, I hope so, right? And that's natural because we know what we've done, we know what we will, what we do, we know what we probably will do. And when we look at ourselves in that way, we realize that none of us are worth the blood of Christ. But we forgot that we were cleaned. We were washed. I think a clear reference to baptism. And in that we were sanctified and we were justified. One of the most encouraging principles found in the Christian faith is that our past doesn't keep us out of heaven. These Corinthian Christians had at one time been and done many things that they shouldn't have done. But God brought them out of it. They were washed. Their souls were washed. There's more in this baptism than a simple bath. Peter alludes to that when he says, not the washing of the filth of the flesh. He's talking about an old bath. I remember being a boy and coming in. We had a well there at the house. It was an old dug well. We loved to take the top off of it and play around it. We didn't love the beating we got every time we took the top off of it. But you'd take that top off and you'd look down in there and you could just see. And it just amazes me how folks were able to come in there and dig a well and take all those rocks and get that ready. And I mean, it was the best water in the world. Just the best. You would put ice in a cup, and when you got done, there'd be all this mineral floating around the bottom of it. But our well and a lot of the water up here, it's got a weird odor to it, sulfur and stuff. We didn't have any of that down there. I mean, clear. The best water I ever drank. And I'm not just talking about nostalgia. I'd take it to work in places and they'd say, man, this water is good. The coal mine went under our house. We lost that well. And of course, the coal mine, they made that right, correct? We had to, my dad had a fella come out and they dug three more wells, drilled ones. Never had water like we did before. But that's another night and another story. Water. There's water in the plan. Marshall Keeble used to debate a lot of folks about baptism. He'd say, there's water in the plan. He said, some people can't find a lick of water in the plan of salvation. They're not in the saving business, they're in the dry cleaning business. How about that? Isn't that a good one? A lot of these preachers preach when they ought to be teaching in the dry cleaning business. What does it mean to be washed? Well, that water was clean as could be when it come through our faucets when I was growing up, but us boys would play out in the dirt all the time, constantly. And what's interesting is that well would go dry. And so we all shared a bath together. It got pretty bizarre looking, I imagine, when I was getting close to being a teenager and I was still in that same bathtub with my brothers. Just filthy. But you'd come out of there and I'd think, how can I be clean when I look down at that water and it looks like mud? It's not talking about the cleaning of the flesh. Consequently, when I took my children to Illinois, we were there for a while, and the men had a meeting with us about some of the bills. And I thought, oh boy. We went in there, and they said, what's going on with your water? I said, what do you mean? He said, we've had a preacher in there for 50 years, and we've never, ever had such a cheap water bill. Do you guys bathe at all? Well, because I was raised that way, my poor girls, Elizabeth will testify to this. They were stuck taking a bath, and then I'd use their water. And when I was done, then we'd let it out. But I was raised to conserve. Were any of you like that? Where you just conserved water? Now, at my house now, I promise you, there is not a drop of water that's conserved, except when I get in, because I've only got about a minute of warm water after all these girls take a shower. But were we washed? What was washed away in that baptistry? The soul was washed. In 1 Corinthians 10, speaking a little bit more about this, in verse 1 he says, "Moreover, brethren, I would not that you should be ignorant how that all our fathers were under the cloud." I'm having trouble with the cloud right now in my sermons. But all of us were under the cloud. What is the cloud he's talking about? That pillar of smoke. And the pillar, the cloud of smoke and the pillar of fire that followed them through the day back when they were crossing the desert and were wandering. And notice, all passed through the sea and were all baptized unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea. They were baptized. Their souls were baptized. Priests were baptized for services. Naaman, a leper, a pagan, was baptized in the Jordan to cleanse his soul. Their filthy garments were washed. Think about it. The first sin in the Bible, what's the one thing that's changed immediately? Their clothes. Their clothes. Adam and Eve's garments were changed. Isaiah told the wayward Israelites their garments could be changed from scarlet to white as snow. I think the most natural illustration I've ever seen. How long have I been preaching? Tommy, have you been keeping track?
20 minutes.
20 minutes. I better. What is it about Sunday night? I can just talk and talk and talk to y'all. It's like the time I preached in the prison. I guess it's a captive audience, right? 20 minutes. I'll try to hurry up here. Sin. How does it get in you? You ever thought about that? How does it get in you? So, I think I told you all this. I did some studying on apples. When I was a kid, there was a large orchard, and down where you live there in the trailer, behind the trailer, that was all orchard back there. You all don't know what I'm talking about, but just imagine there was an orchard on our property. It's not right behind our house. It's kind of down there a little bit. And there were all different sorts of apples. You see, 100-some years ago, that's how people made an apple orchard. You didn't have a whole field full of Granny Smiths or something like that. You just had whatever apples came up that you had, you'd plant them, and you'd have huge varieties. As a matter of fact, they used to have trade shows in America, and there were thousands of different varieties of apples. Unfortunately, now that about three corporations own every produce that you buy is owned by about three different corporations. You've only got about 12 apples now to pick from. But again, that's for another night. But you had all these apples down there, and some of them were little. And one of the things that you just had to deal with was there would be a black spot in it. Now, when there's a black spot in it, what was there? Well, there's a worm in that apple, right? We didn't care about that. Those little apples, we would, matter of fact, many of them we didn't even peel. We put in a gunny sack. And we had this press, and we'd press it, and we'd make all of this apple cider. And I would think to myself, I wonder how many worms I'm drinking. Well, turns out, if you find an apple with a wormhole, it doesn't mean that there is a worm inside the apple. It simply means that an insect laid an egg in the apple blossom. Did you know this? I think I told you all this. You all remember everything that I tell you, so. But yeah, when the thing is just a blossom, an insect will climb in that blossom and they'll lay an egg, and they lay that egg and the apple grows.
Sometime later, the worm hatched in the heart of that apple, and then it ate its way out. So, when you pick the apple that doesn't have a wormhole, you might be thinking, that worm ain't gonna get me. And here it might just be making its way out. So despite the appearance, the worm doesn't work its way into the apple. It works its way out. So if you see a wormhole, there ain't no worm in there. Which makes me feel good about drinking apple cider. And so it is with sin. It doesn't work its way into our hearts. It works its way out of our hearts. You remember what Jesus said about what is in the heart of a man? Or what a man puts in his body? It's not what he puts in his body. It's what comes out of it. Now, that's the thing about that little egg. It may sit there for a while, and it won't manifest until much later through our words and our actions, but it was there all along, hidden in the very blossom of the human heart. Perhaps this is why Jeremiah said, "The heart is desperately wicked above all things." Mark 7 says, "There is nothing from without a man that entering into him can defile him, but the things which come out of him, those are they that defile the man." Their own righteousness was washed. The psalmist said in the 53rd Psalm, "There is none that doeth good, no, not one." Isaiah told the people concerning their righteousness in Isaiah 64, "All our righteousness is as filthy rags." Go home sometime and look up what the original Hebrew meant there for filthy rags. You might be surprised. The Romans were told to exchange their own righteousness for the righteousness of God in Romans 10 and verse 3. Wash me. Have you ever heard of Inez Philip Semmelweis? Or as they would say, didn't you say the W is always a V in German? Semmelweis. You ever heard of this guy? Oh, I think you have. The finest hospitals during his life, he lived around 1818. You remember that year, Tommy? Okay. But the finest hospitals in the early 1800s lost one out of six young mothers to what they called childbed fever. Right now, Laura is reading What to Expect When You're Expecting. Is there a chapter in What to Expect from Your Husband during that time? Because she's telling me what I need to be feeling all the time right now. But one out of six mothers died of childbed fever. So a doctor's daily routine, this is how it happened. It began in the dissecting room where he performed autopsies. So if you were a doctor in 1818, in the morning you would get up, you would go into the dissecting room, you would perform autopsies on dead bodies, because that's what you got paid for. That was a government job. When you were doctoring people, you had to rely on them paying you, and a lot of times they didn't have the money. Now, do you believe doctors took advantage of insurance companies? Or when it comes to insurance, Dale, I know you realize people send the price way up, right? Because they know that they're going to pay. Well, that's, Dale works amongst insurance, just in case you're trying to follow this. Yeah, we need an estimate. So that's what they do in the morning. They'd go in, and their government job was to dissect dead bodies. How about that? Now, guess what they would do next? They made their way to the hospitals to examine expecting mothers. You know what they didn't do? They didn't pause to wash their hands. Well, Dr. Semmelweis was the first man in history to associate such examinations with the resultant infections and death. His own practice was to wash his hands with a chlorine solution, and after 11 years and the delivery of 8,537 babies, he lost only 184 mothers. That is about 1 in 50. Now, the average weight was 1 in 6. And so he lost 1 out of 150. I don't even want to know what the figure is today. Laura's ready to, she's scared already, and so I don't want to scare her tonight. But back then it was pretty rough. But his was a 1 out of 150. What an amazing jump! He spent the vigor of his life going about lecturing and debating with his colleagues. Once he argued this, quote, "Perpetual fever is caused by decomposed material conveyed to a wound. I have shown how it can be prevented. I have proved all that I have said, but while we talk, gentlemen, women are dying. I'm not asking anything world-shaking. I'm asking you only wash, for God's sake, wash your hands." Now, when you hear that today, you would say, duh. I mean, look how obsessed we are with washing hands. I mean, even I now am putting that antibacterial garbage back there on my hands. And how long did I preach? Laura, how do you know that's 99.9% bacteria free? Or kills 99.9% bacteria? I said, is it FDA regulated? No. Nobody regulates that. We're just a bunch of saps that go and buy that thing. And let's say it does work. What's going to happen to that 1% of bacteria that somehow is just open range? But I have been swayed. And now I find myself washing my hands because Laura, she's obsessed with it. She'll look at me, before I come to bed, do you wash your hands? I don't want to wash my hands. I'm warm. If I put my hand under that water, what am I going to be? First thing I do is put my hands on her when I get back in the bed. For God's sake, he said, wash your hands. It's not world shaking. Do you think everybody listened to him? Not a person. Not a person. It would be almost 100 years before doctors would start washing their hands. No one believed him. Doctors and midwives had been delivering babies for thousands of years without washing, and no outspoken Hungarian was going to change that now. Semmelweis, do you know how he died? He died at the age of 47 in an insane asylum. His wash basin discarded, his colleagues laughing in his face, and the death rattle of 1,000 women ringing in his ears. He would walk the halls, they said, screaming, wash, wash. But I think of the anguished prayer of David in Psalm 51. Wash me, O Lord, and restore unto me the joy of my salvation. Wash was the message of John the Baptist. Jesus' message was to Peter this, unless I wash you, you have no part with me. Without our being washed clean, we all die from the contamination of sin. Pretty simple plan, isn't it? And you say amen to Marshall Keeble when he said there's water in the plan for a reason? I'll quit there. Laura and the girls always make fun of me. She said, we've never heard a preacher who will be preaching and all of a sudden say, well, we'll stop here. They've never had an audience like you. I can always tell when it's time. Do you ever render hog fat? Who here has ever rendered? Who here has ever been around when they were rendering? And I mean the process. I'm talking about getting out there, having that pot boiling. What you do is you take all this fat, you throw it in this pot, and you should do it outside. Okay? Because I did it in one time inside and things got ugly. But when you're rendering that, it's called rendering lard. When you're rendering that, what does that stuff look like in the pot? It's almost black, you remember? It's a dark brown, sometimes it's black, and it's just, it's an ugly, it's fat being cooked until it's down to a big glob. Pretty appetizing, isn't it? And then you take that, and you pour it into some kind of canister. We would just pour it into a glass mason jar. Mother made sure that I had a butter knife in it. Apparently that'll keep anything that's scalding hot from breaking the jar. I don't know the physics behind that, but I still do that today. If I'm going to pour anything in a glass jar, I put something metal in it. You pour that in there, and then you pour out that knife, then you'd seal it up, and you've got this jar full of black, brown, yucky gunk. Now, when you looked at it in the morning, guess what color it was?
White
as snow. Now tonight, you might be in that black, yucky, gunky state. I didn't even mention the smell of it. But if you'll let Jesus render you, you can become white as snow. Won't you get